All right, good evening, everybody. We need to get started. We're a few minutes past, but we got a small group tonight. I'm going to say we have a nice, close, intimate setting. Lots of opportunity for people to discuss, and that's what I'm going with. So, good to see everyone. Thank you. I appreciate that. So we're going to be finishing up, theoretically, 2 Peter chapter 2. So we're going, what? So we're going to start with the introduction of lesson 6, and then we won't actually use anything in the book to go back to the previous lesson, but we'll discuss the text that we need to from last week that we didn't get. And hopefully, we'll cruise right on through. You know, I never know in the lessons, like, where we're going to get held up or, like, what's going to cause significantly more discussion than I expected. That always kind of takes me by surprise. Assuming we finish 2 Peter chapter 2, this will be the last week that Peter is going hard at the false teachers in depth. Next week, he'll kind of switch into the positive. Like he's, you know, here are the things that we are actually proposing for the churches that he's writing to. But before we get too far in, why don't we open up in prayer? Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the group that was able to make it out. And I pray that this is a time of whatever we need it to be, whatever you need for us in our lives. I just pray you'd be with us as we examine your word and help us to take from it whatever you have for us tonight. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. Okay. Introduction from your book, page 57. Lesson 6, Dogs and Sows. Sows, is that how it's pronounced? Okay. Yeah, I don't usually refer to pigs that way. Yeah. It's just, yeah. Yeah, no, not yet. Give it time. All right. Peter describes false teachers through picturesque language. One of the images he uses is that of a pig. A pig by nature will wallow in mud and filth from its youngest days, no matter how many times its owner washes off all its dirt and grime. Actually, all that wallowing helps a pig develop good bacteria in its gut and stay healthier throughout its life. Peter's point is that false teachers act according to their nature when they roll in the mud pit of sin. There is no silver lining, though, to their wallowing in sin. Strange question to start off with, but what are some common actions of pigs? Clearly, I know nothing about pigs, so, you know, you can educate me. They like to eat? Yeah. Yes, they do. Just about anything, right? Mm-hmm. Is that how we eat? They eat garbage? Yeah. Roll in the mud, big fans of that. I've heard this. They're very smart. Like, comparable to dogs, I've heard. I guess it depends on the breed of dog, but yeah, they're supposed to be pretty smart. I was thinking about that. I'm like, why is that considered delicious food? But we draw the lines with, like, dogs. No, you can't do that. At least not in the West. And of course, naturally. Okay, some of this will probably be cut from the video, it's fine. This is why sometimes prep takes me forever, because I go down mental rabbit trails where I'm like, wonder how we do decide what foods are pets and what foods are, or what animals are pets and what animals are food. I think it's usefulness. That's what I came to, you know? dogs, especially historically, like they'll hunt for you, they'll guard your house, they'll attack your enemies if you train them right. They can herd your cattle. Like, that's super useful historically. Like, why would you? That's not food. That's right. Yeah, that's bizarre. But yeah, people have always used them for work. You know, like you have a whole bunch of sheep, and you find you can have like a dog or two that keeps your you can get one animal that keeps your other animals in line. That's insane. You can use them for like war. You know, release the dogs, release the hounds. Same with horses, ox. Like that's not commonly eaten because they're too useful. I'm gonna cut all this. This is getting away from me, getting out of hand. Interesting. Question number two. Would you expect a pig? So, okay, back to pigs and the things that they do. Would you expect a pig to act any differently? Explain. I feel like they kind of summed up their thoughts in the paragraph already. Yeah, so no, typically the point the book is making, of course, is that things do not act differently than their nature. Things act according to their nature. Which is sort of a pessimistic way to look at things, or perhaps just a darkly realistic, maybe, perhaps it's a realistic way to look at things, and we're in a fallen world, so sometimes realism is dark. So, we get the point that our book is making. Why don't we get to the text? We're going to look at 2 Peter 2. We're going to do verses 14 through 17, which we read last week. We won't get crazy far into it, but we should cover the content. All right, 2 Peter 2:14, still talking about the false teachers, of course. It says they are having eyes full of adultery and that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls. A heart they have exercised with covetous practices, cursed children, which have forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness, but was rebuked for his iniquity. The dumb ass, speaking with a man's voice, forbade the madness of the prophet. So we didn't get to talk about Balaam last week. What do we know about this guy? Okay, he was bad. I like it. Accurate based on context. He was greedy. Okay. Yeah, do we remember this story at all? Maybe you remember the name, but it's a little fuzzy. Okay, so we can look back. Yeah, so why don't you keep your spot where you are in 2 Peter and turn back to Numbers 22. I'll give you some background and then we'll get there. So Balaam is an interesting person because he is known historically. So there was this discovery in, in the 1920s, in a place that is now called Deir Allah in Jordan. And they found this thing that is considered like the oldest version of an Aramaic book. It was not what we think of as a book, but these like plaster pieces. Think of almost like a piece of tile made out of some sort of plaster that had ink on it, and then they kind of bound it together, but codex technology is not really there yet. And it talks about this guy named Balaam, this known ancient prophet, and this prophecy he gave about some like village somewhere going to be destroyed by some pagan gods. And the story of Balaam in the Bible takes place mostly from Numbers 22 through 24. So it's a long series of events that we're not going to read. It's a bit enigmatic because there are just points in the story that the Bible just doesn't tell you certain things and kind of leaves you to fill in some gaps. And some of the story is picked up later in Deuteronomy when Moses is just explaining some things to the children of Israel, where you kind of get a look into like some of the motives of what's going on with Balaam. So basically, Balaam is like an internationally known sorcerer, I guess, is probably the best explanation for him. He's a pagan prophet, the king of, I believe, Moab. Yeah, the king of Moab comes to him because Balaam has this reputation that, hey, whatever people you bless will be blessed, whoever you curse is cursed. So he basically is trying. The Israelites, in their wilderness wanderings, have gotten to the border of Moab. The king of Moab is concerned, and he's going to go try to hire some magician to curse these people. That's his plan. So it's interesting that, so I told you he's historical. Several times throughout the narrative, as Balaam identifies himself, it's ironic as we're going to read the story, he identifies himself as Balaam, the one who sees, because he's this prophet. And he constantly gives himself this title. He is the one with vision. He's the one who sees. The king of Moab tries to hire him. Initially, God speaks to him, and he says, hey, don't go. And then he says, okay, a second time, he says, okay, go. And then there's clearly some bizarre, enigmatic series of events, because Balaam goes, and this is what we're going to read, and God is angry that he went, but you're like, a few verses away, didn't you tell him to go? Moses supplies the details of his motivations later as to why this is a problem. Okay, so Numbers 22:22. So this is as Balaam is leaving to go with the king of Moab. Verse 22. And God's anger was kindled because he went, and the angel of the Lord stood in the way for an adversary against him. Now he was riding upon his ass, and his two servants were with him. And the ass saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand. And the ass turned aside out of the way and went into the field. Balaam smote the ass to turn her into the way. But the angel of the Lord stood in a path of the vineyards, a wall being on this side and a wall on that side. And when the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she thrust herself into the wall and crushed Balaam's foot against the wall, and he smote her again. The angel of the Lord went further and stood in a narrow place where there was no way to turn either to the right hand or to the left. When the ass saw the angel of the Lord, she fell down under Balaam. Balaam's anger was kindled, and he smote the ass with a staff. The Lord opened the mouth of the ass, and she said unto Balaam, what have I done unto thee, that thou hast smitten me these three times? Balaam, not thinking this is as strange as we do, said unto the ass, because thou hast mocked me, I wish there was a sword in my hand, for now I would kill thee. The ass said unto Balaam, am not I thine ass upon which thou hast ridden ever since I was thine unto this day? Was I ever wont to do so unto thee? And he said, no. Then the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand. And he bowed down his head and fell flat on his face. The angel of the Lord said unto him, wherefore hast thou smitten thine ass these three times? Behold, I went out to withstand thee, because thy way is perverse before me. And the ass saw me and turned from me these three times. Unless she had turned from me, surely now also I would have slain thee and saved her alive. Balaam said unto the angel of the Lord, I have sinned, for I knew not that thou stoodest in the way against me. Now therefore, if it displease thee, I will get me back again. The angel of the Lord said unto Balaam, go with the men, but only the word that I shall speak unto thee, that shalt thou speak. So Balaam went with the prince of Balak. What are our thoughts on this? Right? Yeah. Shrek. Talking donkey. He didn't skip a beat, right? Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely an odd story. There's definitely irony at play. Again, as I told you at the beginning, Balaam, son of Beor, the one who sees. And in this event, his animal is the one who, for some reason, can see the angel of the Lord blocking his path. Balaam is completely ignorant of the situation, even though he thinks himself this great and mighty prophet and sorcerer. The dog staring at the wall, yeah. The cat, yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, that probably comes from a lot of things, because animals are much more sensitive. Like your dog or cat might freak out before a storm, before you know it's coming. Although, let me throw this out there. I was freaked out when I learned this. So they always used to think dogs could see in black and white. They're like, oh yeah, they're basically colorblind. Not so. Cats and dogs see in ultraviolet, which means they see color frequencies at a higher, they see colors at a higher frequency range than we do. So I'm like, oh, so what happens when your cat's just staring up at the middle of the ceiling, freaking out? You're like, oh, well, they can see spectrums we can't, and that is alarming because maybe they're actually seeing something. This is not official church teaching. This is more of a small group. That concerns me. It concerns me that the cat is seeing something I can't. I find it alarming. You're talking about Numbers 32? Or, you know, 22:32?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, 32 is just the angel of the Lord saying him, you know, why have you beaten the donkey these times? Basically, I'll lay out sort of the point of the story. Okay, I wanted to give you the scene with Balaam and the donkey, because that's precisely what Peter quotes to. Peter expects his audience to hyperlink to the entire story. Otherwise, if you just reading these verses here, all you have is a story about a guy and a donkey, and you're like, what's going on here? Fair question. So, as the king of Moab wanted Balaam to come and curse the children of Israel, he's offering him enormous sums of money. Balaam turns him down the first time. He sends messengers back with even more money, and the Lord says to him, yeah, you can go. And then you get this odd scene. And you go, like, why is God angry with him? There's a line where he's like, yeah, your way is perverse before me, or something to that effect. So even though God told him to go, it's clear something is off. So whatever's happening, maybe Balaam is intending to go to do what this king commands, to curse the children of Israel. Maybe that's what's in his heart. And God says, like, yeah, go, only say what I tell you. So this very interesting scene plays out when he gets with the king of Moab. They're up on this high crest of some sort, and the camp of Israel is down below. And the king of Moab says to Balaam, yeah, I need you to curse the children of Israel. So they set up, like, 7 altars. They sacrifice 7 things, and instead of a curse, Balaam comes out with this blessing for the children of Israel. And the king's like, what are you doing? This is not what we agreed to. So they do it again, and he's like, hey, I can only announce what God told me. So he does this 3 times, and every time, because he's like, oh, well, maybe if we set up altars over on that ridge, maybe I can curse them. And this happens 3 times. And every time he's supposed to be cursing the children of Israel, and he just blesses the children of Israel. And then he gets 4 more, Balaam does 4 more blessings, like, for free, I guess. It's the odd thing, Balaam is a pagan prophet that God actually uses for his own purposes, because there's some pretty significant prophecy in there that links to at least probably like David, and then in further retrospect, the Messiah. So like God uses him for some very important words. And then you have this incident where all you learn from the immediate text is that even though Balaam couldn't curse Israel, you have this situation where Israel starts worshiping the idols of Moab and sleeping with their temple prostitutes. And it's like this very odd, quick turnaround. And you find out later, it seems like what Balaam did, he goes, well, he wasn't permitted to curse the children of Israel. God wouldn't speak to him that way. But he seemed to come up with a plan. It's kind of like, okay, so I can't curse Israel. I can show you how to get Israel to curse themselves. And seems to give the king advice to lead the children of Israel into idolatry and adultery, very much commingled. And there's this big plague that breaks out. That's the fiery serpents, I believe. Or maybe it's not. I don't know. Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah, I'm just drawing a blank on which plague it was, but that's not the point. So, Peter reference. Yeah, so it's this character that seems at first like, oh wow, God using this pagan prophet in a very interesting way, using a pagan man for his own glory. Awesome. And then Balaam does his thing. He seems to give in to greed and tempt Israel to religious and sexual immorality. So Peter, as he's doing his whole list of things about false prophets, he points back to the story of Balaam and the fact that Balaam, he couldn't see the angel of the Lord. He couldn't see the God thing standing in his way. His animal has more vision than him. And he's calling them people who will lead people into idolatry and sexual perversion, as he's been, you know, talking about this kind of stuff all through. So it's funny, because, I mean, we can go back to 2 Peter. You know, that takes us 20 minutes to break down to his Jewish, like, to the audience that's been just inundated, whether they're Jewish or just Gentiles being inundated with the Old Testament scriptures. Yeah, he expected that to just be, oh yeah, you know the story of Balaam when his donkey was talking to him. Yeah, oh yeah, no, that's a great comparison, interesting. Like, and that's it. Okay. So that's what we have with Balaam. Now let's move on in 2 Peter 17, and we'll go through 22. That seems like too much. Yeah, no, that's okay. All right, 17 through 22. These are wells without water, still false teachers. They're wells without water, clouds that are carried with a tempest, to whom the mist of darkness is reserved forever. For when they speak great swelling words of vanity, they allure through the lusts of the flesh, through much wantonness, those that were clean escaped from them who live in error. While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought into bondage. For if, after they escape the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness, then, after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. Do you like the pronunciation there? That was, got that one. Every day, every day. And I will rarely use that word, so I may forget it in the near future. Any thoughts on that? Couple tricky verses. It's mostly straightforward otherwise. Yeah, he's sort of summing up his ideas here. Yeah. Okay. Why don't we look in our textbook, or whatever we call this, at page 58. If I read anything that's not in your book, roll with it. I have paragraphs later that I needed to underline what was in my book and what was in your book because it, I don't know. There should be a paragraph that starts with, Peter's writings are powerful. He catches your attention with his picturesque style as he describes the false teachers who invade the church with their heresies. The apostle uses two very colorful metaphors to describe the spiritual bankruptcy of these apostates. Peter speaks of their spiritual dryness as springs without water, and their spiritual impotence as clouds driven away by a storm. Such word pictures portray the truth in unforgettable ways. Question 3. What thoughts come to mind when Peter describes false teachers as waterless wells and clouds that promise rain without delivering any? It's false expectations, you know? Like, they build up, like, it looks like it should be something, and then it's nothing. Yeah, two good water. And it's interesting, he used two water metaphors, one from the ground and one from the sky. Kind of like from, you know, the depths of the earth to the heights of heaven, they got nothing. That's pretty interesting. Verse 18, for they speak great swelling words of vanity. They allure through the lust of the flesh, through much wantonness, those that were clean escaped from them who live in error. If anything was tricky, the second half of that verse is a little tricky. But before we get to that, so this isn't in your book, but the next paragraph will be. So listen to this. They say, the goal is to draw young Christians by their theological jargon. The word allure is a fishing term. They use the exaggerated speech and angling for young Christians. Their bait is promise of unrestrained indulgence in lust and passion. This is the meaning of wantonness. They no doubt maintain that physical and sexual appetites are God-given and should be satisfied. Just do what comes natural. Morals need to be relaxed. Fortunately, we have no such teaching in 2023 in America, so we don't need to discuss that. No. No, that was heavy with sarcasm. But go to page 60 in your book. There's a paragraph that starts with, the potential attraction of some relatively new Christians is due to their level of understanding. These are new believers who are just escaping the moral corruption of their unsaved lives. They've had a change of heart and need to leave the unrestrained behavior of their old lives behind as new creatures in Christ. The appeal to them is that while they are saved, they still have the right to indulge in unrestrained sensual experiences. So, I believe the book's right in what it's getting at here. So we've already discussed that the type of false teachers Peter is talking about are not true converts. So we've already discussed that in detail. What he's saying here is basically with these enticing words, the speech of these false prophets, they allure those who have just escaped the corruption of the world. So like people who have new Christians, people who have just been saved, who they've had true faith experience and don't have the proper knowledge to really understand what the problems are. Mm. Right. Well, and they were saying, like, what the book was saying, the idea of, like, okay, someone who's a new Christian, and then you kind of tell them, oh, well, yeah, but you use all these fancy theological words, but this thing isn't actually wrong. You can still live this way. You can do this. God is this. He accepts, you know. And when you are crafting a faith or cult or whatever it is, where it like gives pretty much free license to a lot of the sinful desires of the flesh anyway, yeah, if you don't have the knowledge to deal with that, that would obviously be very tempting for people. So yeah, that's the idea of what that's getting at there, the second half of that verse. Those that were clean escaped, yeah, through much wantonness, those that were cleanness. Yeah, it's worded very confusingly, but I do believe that's what that's getting at there. All right, why don't we drill down on the last section of verses? Yeah, I probably shouldn't have read them at the beginning, but let's just read again verses 19 through 22 and see what your thoughts are. So while they promised them liberty, false teachers promised the people liberty, they themselves are servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought into bondage. For if, after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are entangled again therein and overcome, the latter is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness, than after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his vomit again, and the sow is washed to her wallowing. The sow is washed to her wallowing in the mire. Yeah, what are your thoughts on some of those verses? We mostly talked about the first two. Yeah, that especially that verse 20, what he's, you know, 20-21, like Ron's talking about. Because yeah, there's a few possibilities going on there, and I think. What the book seems to get at is like, okay, so we know the false teachers, the way they are talked about, like we said, they are not true converts. They are using the gospel for their own malicious intent. So he talks about them like having this head knowledge, like they know the way of Jesus and then return to their own lusts and pagan ideologies. So even when you're talking about someone who is just completely unsaved, he says, like, yeah, you know what? It would have been better for them to just be living their unsaved life than to know the truth and to still pervert the entire thing. There's also kind of this sense of, we'll read some stuff in the book about it. But there's this idea of, like, verse 21. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them. There's like a few. There's a few ways you can take it, because I think again, like we just said, if you're still unregenerate, but you know the truth of the gospel and then pervert it for your own ways, yeah, you're like worse off than you were at the beginning. Also, if you are that new Christian who is being kind of pulled into these teachings, if you're actually saved, if you actually have faith, of course you're redeemed. But then if you go back to your pagan ways through these false teachings, it's like, man, you're going to be in a rough spot. You know, especially some of that stuff can be tough. If you're a Christian and then early on you get sucked into something that sort of sounds like Christianity, like these false teachers who twist scripture. So it's like, okay, you're a Christian. Early on, you get sucked into something that sounds Christian, but is this very off, messed up, perverted thing. You know, whatever version of false teaching they're selling here, like, that really messes people up. You know, you get people coming out of all sorts of different like church experiences with just a host of different problems. I mean, we've talked about everything from like some of the more extremely liberal church teachings now. We talk about like prosperity gospel type stuff. Like if you're a young Christian and you get pulled into the prosperity gospel type stuff, that's hard. That's going to be hard to come out of, or it's going to be hard to come out of and still have a positive view of things, even if your spirit is like, no, I know God's real, but I don't understand this, and this is, you know, you can really get messed up by this. But yeah, especially if they are still unsaved, their judgment is going to be worse. Yeah, I just watched a Netflix documentary on Waco, and I was like, oof, yeah, wow. It seemed very relevant to Peter, even though that's perhaps a more extreme version of what tends to happen. That's the problem. Like, everything from, you know, a person who ends up donating, like, their last ounce of savings to the prosperity preacher, minister, to like people whose faith is shattered because they said, if you just have enough faith, you know, your sibling's cancer will go away, like this or that, all the way to like very extreme versions of like that kind of stuff. Like bad doctrine has consequences. We tend to think of it as like, oh, you know, it's all this doctrinal, oh, theology, it's this heady kind of theoretical type stuff, but bad doctrine wrecks people's lives, and they don't always realize that their thinking was the problem, not God, you know, so the lessons are really important that Peter's trying to get at. I do want to look in your book on page 61. This is a paragraph where, like, half of it's in your book and half of it's not. I'll try to differentiate for you. Page 61, it starts with, Peter describes the false teachers as those who for a time escaped the moral pollution of the world, but then reverted to their old paganism. This isn't in your book. They have sunken even lower morally than before. This is in your book. Peter says the last state is worse than the first. This is not in your book. He echoes the warning of Christ about the man who had an evil spirit returned to him, reinforced by seven other evil spirits in Matthew 12. The man had apparently experienced some sort of a reformation, but his latter end was worse after the demon returned with its companions. And if you don't remember that parable, I'm sorry, we're not digging into it now. We can talk about it later. And then, top of page 62. All right, it's the religious reformation that occurs in the conduct of these teachers is due to their knowledge of Jesus Christ. Their knowledge of Christ is, however, only a head knowledge rather than a heart knowledge. In fact, they reject the truth. Peter uses no terms about them that would indicate they are Christians. Personal faith involves the inner man. We believe with our hearts and then make a confession with our mouths. Christ spoke of the stony hearers whose profession is short-lived due to their lack of deep trust, like Ron mentioned, Matthew 13. Their profession did not have roots that extended down to the faith in their hearts. The evidence of their spiritual bankruptcy points to an absence of genuine faith. This is why the apostle exhorted believers earlier in the letter to conduct a serious self-examination. Yeah, so I think we'll basically leave it here. Or maybe I should ramble for about five more minutes, because, I mean, it's only 7:55. It feels wrong. But no, you can... Yeah, no, but that's a really good point, because, you know, so we've talked about the overt, like, okay, you're really over-the-top prosperity-type stuff, or your faith-healing-type stuff, or, you know, even, like, bizarre cult-type stuff. And, yeah, we're... I think everyone here is pretty good with like, okay, yeah, I don't think if I send you all my money, then I'm going to get that back tenfold because I sent it to you, you know. It's more nuanced, but basically. So like, I think for the most part, we're pretty good on that kind of stuff. Like, we're not really in danger of that. But like the idea of, yeah, like bad doctrine has consequences. Even like, okay, how works-based is your system, you know? Of course, we are all on board for good works and sanctification. If your eternal destiny is wrapped up in, if I did the right number of things at the right number of time, went to the right number of mass and, you know, this many, you know. Oh, like that's a big portion of the world. Now, you know, we don't need to go down that rabbit hole. But like, yeah, those are major branches that call themselves Christian that add on innumerable things and then say, yeah, if you don't follow these, you don't believe these, then you're outside the church. That's pretty bad. A lot of people, like, being a Methodist could mean they're almost identical to us, except for a few minor changes. If you're like a lot of like the Wesleyan Methodists, you know, pretty close. You know, they have some points of disagreement. Or you can be extremely liberal in every possible way. You can just kind of go down the list of denominations and you go like, yeah, no, it's easier to fall off the ditch, you know, into the ditch one side of the road or the other. Even as we're thinking about just like what we would call normal run-of-the-mill Christianity, because we're really only concerned with the false teachers of Christianity in this topic. You know, Peter's not addressing the priests of Zeus or something like that. It's like, okay, people have taken God's word and twisted it. Sometimes that can be major, sometimes it can be minor, and sometimes the minor ones, like Pastor said, are more difficult to notice. And sometimes a minor shift on a really important topic eventually takes you far down a road that makes things look very different in the long run. Not to make us paranoid, but it's something to consider. Like, I think that might end up being like a motto going forward. Like, doctrine has consequences, you know? That's pretty good. Maybe I can get more alliteration going. I'll have to think about it. I'll get something pithier. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, hopefully it is. So, we managed to go 5 minutes past, so we crushed it. We did a great job. We were in danger of finishing 5 minutes early, but we managed to go 5 minutes past. So, excellent. Excellent work. Excellent work, everybody. Why don't we close in prayer? Lord, thank you for this night. Thank you for everything that we could discuss. Thank you for your word, that it's still shockingly relevant 2,000 years after it's written. I just pray that we would take it to heart, and that we would, again, not be paranoid, but be able to trust the guidance of your Spirit and your word to allow us to rest assured in truth. So we thank you for it. We pray you would help us to consider whatever you need us to, whatever is needed in our lives now or in the future. So we thank you. Pray you'd be with us. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen.